This is what we're going to talk about today. I'm going to start out the presentation by giving you some overall fraud trend updates on occupational fraud. And occupational fraud is fraud that is perpetrated against an employer by their own employees. We're then going to morph into some of the specific types of fraud schemes that we see most prevalently in the construction and real estate industry. And along with that, I'll explain what those schemes are, how they're perpetrated, red flags, give you some effective anti-fraud controls, and give you a couple of war stories in there as well. Because, you know, let's face it, that's what really makes it interesting, is hearing about what happened to somebody else. All right, so we'll start with the top fraud trends. And what I'm going to talk about this afternoon is largely taken from the Association of Certified Fraud Examiners 2016 report to the nations. The ACFE is the professional organization that credentials people like me who investigate financial fraud for a living. So every 2 years, they survey us and say, tell us about the frauds you investigated in the last 2 years. What industries were they in? What level of person perpetrated them? What were the schemes? How much money was taken, etc.? And then they pull all of that information together every 2 years in a publicly available report, the Report to the Nations, which is on their website. The 2018 report should be out in the day. I was actually hoping it would make it before this presentation, but it's not been published yet. So the top headline out of that report every 2 years is the estimate of how much the typical company in any industry loses to fraud on an annual basis. And the estimate is usually between 5% and 7%. And as you would, you know, think it might, it kind of varies based upon how the U.S. economy is doing. So in 2016, it was about 5%. For the construction real estate industry itself, the median loss per occurrence, so every time it happens, the median loss is $259,000. That's a top line revenue. And, you know, some people, $259,000, if you're a several million dollar revenue company, is it that bad? Well, think about how many additional people's salary that amount of money would pay. So it's usually, it can cause significant pain. And in addition, there are other costs associated with the fraud besides just the amount of money that the person took when they were leaving to go out the door. You've got the cost of external assistance with an investigation if you're going forward for insurance or for criminal prosecution. Likely, you're going to have to involve outside counsel, you're going to have to pay lawyers, you're going to have to pay forensic accountants such as myself. And, you know, we all cost money. We're good at what we do, but we aren't necessarily inexpensive. And unfortunately, if you make an insurance claim, many times what that means is in the next couple of years, your insurance premiums are going to be higher. So you're kind of paying for this cost of this fraud over a multi-year basis. And there are actually some non-monetary damages that can be more damaging on a long-term basis than the amount of the fraud that walked out the door, the amount of the money. Let's think about the loss of reputation to your company. Let's assume that your loss was significant enough, what had happened in your company was interesting enough that it made the news. It made the newspaper and the radio. And it's all over town, it's all over your market area. People are going to start making assumptions about your company, rightly or wrongly, particularly if senior management is involved in the fraud. You know, it's very common that people will assume, well, you know, that company really doesn't have their house in order, they don't have the controls in place that they need to have, and then the next thing they think is, do I really want to hire that company for my next big project? So again, it's more than just the amount of money that walks out the door. If it's a significant enough fraud that you have to have an internal investigation, there are additional types of losses that occur. And one of them is loss of employee morale. When I come into a company to do an investigation, I look at a lot of documentation, but at some point in the process, I sit down and I start interviewing employees. And even if the employee that I'm interviewing is purely background information for me, it's uncomfortable to have somebody sit across the table and ask you what you know about things. And the employees start to wonder, does she think I'm involved? Does management think I'm involved? And that's stressful to them. And it can cause a lot of, you know, water cooler topics of discussion. In addition, very often, they'll start thinking about their coworkers and suggesting that people are involved who I'll know for a fact had absolutely nothing to do with the fraud that we're investigating. But, you know, the rumor mills start, productivity and morale can fall. In addition, anytime you've got an internal investigation, we require a lot of assistance from the internal employees in pulling information for us, answering questions, so they have to be taken off their normal jobs in order to work with us. Now, unfortunately, the majority of the time when somebody perpetrates a financial fraud, the money is gone. They've spent it. It's not sitting there in an interest-bearing account although I do have one example where that happened. So about 58% of the time, there's absolutely no recovery. So here's our first war story. This is a company, probably about a medium-sized company, and this is probably about 7 or 8 years ago at this point. The owner of the company called, and he said, Shauna, we think we have a problem with our accounting. We're not sure what's going on. We are generating more revenue than we've ever generated, but we are having less money drop to the bottom line. So what he's basically saying is, there's a leak somewhere in there. The money's coming in as expected, but it's not staying. He said, we've looked around, we can't find it. Can you guys kind of come and kick the tires and help us see if we can figure out what the problem is? So we go out there, and when we do an internal investigation, there is a theory to who we interview when. It's kind of like a bullseye. You start with the people on the outside of the ring that you think may have some knowledge of the issue, but that you're pretty sure were not involved. So you're wanting to get your background information, and then you kind of go through rings of, you know, next level people that are more likely involved and more likely involved, until hopefully the last person that you're interviewing is the person you're pretty certain was responsible for the fraud. And by the time you're interviewing them, you already actually know the majority of the answers to the questions you're going to be asking them. Because what you're doing, what your goal is at that point, is to get them to confess. So anytime I'm getting ready for those types of interviews, I spend a lot of time. I used to actually pull out, you know, the yellow legal pads and write questions, and I write questions a couple of different ways, going for the same answer to see if the person would contradict themselves. So I've been up most of the previous night getting ready to interview Mr. Smith, and I go in there the next morning. He's my first interview. I walk in. Hello, Mr. Smith. My name is Shauna Woody Cousins. You were hired by the owner of your company to look into some accounting matters, and I'd like to talk to you about them. And he just stopped me right there, and he said, I did it. I took the money. I'll tell you how I took the money. And then he pulled open the top right-hand drawer on his desk, and he pulled out some bank statements and a printout of an Excel worksheet. And he said, here's the fraud. This is how I took the money. Every time he took it, he had put it in an Excel spreadsheet. He had date and time stamped it. Never seen this happen. And then he's showing me the bank account statements. All the money is there. He hasn't touched any of it, and it's earning interest. Okay, so most people, when they steal money because they want to spend it, right? You don't just steal money to put to invest in a bank account, earning not a lot of interest. And I said, okay, so what's going on here? So the short story behind it was, about 18 months before that, he had found that there was a gap in the company's internal controls. And so he had gone to the owner of the company and he told him about this gap. But the owner, rather than saying, oh, thank you so much, that's great, you were wonderful, I really appreciate that, said, oh, you know, that's not really a big deal, get back to work. Kind of just, you know, told the guy to go away. And basically, the guy felt disrespected. So what he decided to do was perpetrate the fraud. But he really didn't want to steal the money. He was actually an honest guy. He was making a point. So he perpetrated the fraud and he put it in the bank in an interest-bearing account, and there all the money sat. So as we had been investigating this particular issue, when we would have our interviews with the company owner, he was a very dramatic individual. He got very emotional talking about this. He was making comments about taking people's firstborn child and things like that once we found out who had perpetrated this. So after I talked to the gentleman who took the money, I said, okay, now we're going to go get the owner, and you're going to get to tell the owner what you just told me. So we're sitting across the table from the owner, and Mr. Smith is explaining what's going on, and the owner's face is getting redder and redder. He's got one of those veins in the middle of his forehead that's becoming rather pronounced. And I thought, you know, this is going to go really, really badly. So after Mr. Smith finishes his say and sits there for a moment, the owner's kind of quiet for about 30 seconds, and I'm like, oh, here it comes. And he actually says, how would you like to be the CFO? Okay, if you steal money, even if you don't spend it, that's fraud. If you steal the money, that's fraud. But in this particular case, the owner said, well, you know, he had come to me and he had told me that we had an issue and that if I didn't do something about it, this may happen. So he probably actually had my best interest at heart, so I think I should reward him for that. I'm sure I'll never see that happen again. Like I said, the majority of the time, the money is completely gone, but there was that one time. Now, in about 12% of the frauds that were reported in which there is a full recovery and the company gets 100% of the loss back, it is usually because they have the appropriate type of insurance. And in days gone by, it used to be pretty easy to fill out a proof of loss and just kind of lay out the specifics, add a couple of documents, send it to the insurance company, and you'd get paid. But things are kind of changing a little bit at this point in time. So what I've got here is an example of an excerpt from one of our actual investigative documents. And this happened to be an investigation for a bank, but it really wouldn't have mattered what industry it was in. In this particular case, what the insurance company is saying is that in your application to receive insurance from us, you told us that the correspondent account, suspense account, or transit account that is used most often by dishonest employees, that all of these accounts are reconciled and balanced regularly and completely balanced and reconciled by a second person at least monthly. And we relied upon that comment that you made when we agreed to give you insurance. So when the bank actually filed its claim, its proof of loss, they said, a walkthrough of examples enclosed with your letter states as follows. Mr. Smith was responsible for reconciling the general ledger balance to the correspondent bank account statement, and therefore, the resulting differences were not detected by other bank personnel. So basically what they're saying is, in our application, we told you we had two at least people doing this. In reality, we did not. So what the insurance company says is, okay, that's fine. You misrepresented your controls to us on your application. We therefore have the right to act as if you never have insurance at all and we don't have to pay your bond claim. And they didn't. So we're seeing more and more of this day and age. In fact, I'm just finishing up a proof of loss for one of my clients on a significant loss. It's about a $1.8 million loss. The report itself is about, I think I'm about 15 pages. The exhibits to support it are 387 pages. So that's how much documentation the insurance companies are now requiring to support loss. They want everything documented down to the T. Now, occupational fraud is not like, you know, some other types of criminals that you may think about. You know, occupational fraudsters aren't scary looking. They don't have a lot of tattoos. They aren't the type of people that you would cross to the other side of the street if you see them coming towards you. In fact, 88% of fraudsters have not previously been charged or convicted of a financial related fraud. So, but a lot of that is because we think about 40% of frauds are actually ever reported publicly, and a lot of it is due to that reputational risk issue that I talked about. People don't want everybody else, all the other businesses in their neighborhoods, knowing that they've been the victim of a fraud. So we always recommend that background checks on employees are very, very important. And in reality, under today's employment laws, a lot of times you will call a company and all they're allowed to say is whether or not the person you're inquiring about actually worked there. But the way they say it may make a lot of difference. If somebody says, well, yes, Shauna Woody Cousins worked here, versus, yeah, Shauna was here. You know, that kind of has a couple of implications there. So we always tell our clients, very, very important that you do your background checks and on those references, actually call and ask about the people that you're employing. Specifically, if you're going to employ them into a sensitive position, and by sensitive position, I mean anything that has anything to do with money, finance, or accounting. So let's play a quick little game here. Just to yourself, which one of these do you think looks suspicious? Which one of these is our fraudster? Most people choose the guy in the middle on the bottom. He just kind of looks guilty to a lot of people. In reality, they all are. So what I've just put up on the screen there is how much money each one of these individuals took from their employers. If we start with the lady in the sunglasses on the top right, that's Irene Bruner. She was when Galvin met in Kansas City. She stole $3 million basically by writing checks to herself out of the corporate account and depositing them into her own account. Now, unfortunately, her company was not large enough to sustain this level of a loss, and they had to clear bankruptcy and were bought by another company. The guy in the middle is the guy I dislike the most. That's 82-year-old Rusty Grace. He was the president of a mid-coast charities, and this particular charity was involved in doing things like providing emergency food and heating and things like that to people. And this guy stole $4.6 million in donation checks by setting up a company that had a name very similar to the name of the nonprofit and then depositing those checks. So what that means is that a significant number of people who needed food, utilities, family stay didn't get it. The woman on the top, far top right there, that's Celia Chang. She was a fundraiser for St. John's University, and she was very good at what she did. She took about $1 million in a fairly short period of time and her deal was just supporting her lavish lifestyle. But in her case, she also bought things like Hugo Boss suits for some of her superiors so that they wouldn't turn her in. The woman on the bottom here, she is the one big winner in terms of a dollar amount, $31 million. That's Sue Sachdeva. She was the controller of Cost Corporation. The interesting thing about her was the majority of hers was done by using the corporate American Express card for personal purchases. And the way the company found out about it was that American Express called them and said, hey, not for nothing, but we're seeing your corporate card being used at a lot of places that don't appear to us would have anything to do with what your business is involved in. You might want to take a look at it. I also wonder how you spend $31 million on a credit card. It's got to take a lot of effort to that. The guy in the middle there, that's John Hardwick IV. He's an attorney, and he had a title and closing company, and he embezzled $20 million out of the corporate coffers. His big deal was that he did have some gambling issues, and he had a very lavish lifestyle, but what he took the majority of the money for was that he had three ex-wives, and none of them liked him very much, and so they got really, really good settlements, and he was using the company money to pay for that. And then our last gentleman there, that is John Howard. He worked for the Nashville Municipal Airport Organization, and he was in charge of hiring contractors to do work at the airport. But kind of what his scheme was he kind of colluded with a couple of his contractor buddies, and he would put forth contracts and pay them for those contracts, but no work was ever done, and they would turn around and kick him back some of that money on the side. So this is kind of our current wall of shame here. So let's talk for a minute about who commits occupational fraud. Now, if you talk about frequency, it's your line employees, usually. Your employees are responsible for about 41% of the frauds. The median loss they cause per occurrence is about $65,000. As you go up in responsibility, the size of the frauds get larger, but the frequency of the fraud actually falls. And you end up with owners and executives that really are only responsible for frauds about 19% of the time, but their median loss in 2016 was about $703,000. Now, most people, when we talk about employee stealing, they'll say, well, the reason your employees are stealing is because they're not paid enough, and that's why they're stealing. And when you think about it, you might think that makes common sense. In actuality, that's erroneous. The reason, most often reason, behind an employee stealing is because they are dissatisfied with their work environment. They feel they have not been respected, they have been passed over for a promotion, or something like that. They feel there is a need to even the score. So once we investigate those and talk to people about why they perpetrated their fraud, that's the most common reason we see in the employee level. So that kind of brings up the flip side of that question. Why do some very well-heeled owners and executives steal money, particularly from their own companies that they own? It's like, isn't it theirs anyway? Well, we do see, you know, a lot of the same type of addictions that get out of hand. Quite frankly, in my practice, the number one reason I see fraud perpetrated is because of a gambling addiction. And it may be just online, they may not actually be going to the casinos, but we see it frequently enough that we do a lot of computer forensics, and I'll have the lab look for evidence of online gaming, and an awful lot of the time we find it. But also, for some level of these people, it's just pure out greed, and it doesn't matter how much they have, enough is never enough. There's a gentleman in Kansas City who was involved in payday loan scams. He's recently been criminally charged, convicted, and got about almost 17 years in prison. If you look at everything the man had before he started perpetrating his bad acts, he had more money than probably all of us here put in the room together might ever have. But you know, when they finally arrested him and started seizing his assets, he also had $400 million in various bank accounts sitting across the country, along with a $60 million racing company that he owned, with several cars and several homes and that type of things, a Learjet, and in his case, I think it was just pure greed, and there wasn't ever going to be enough toys or money that he could have to satisfy his issue. We also have some of the extreme cases, and these are the cases you most often see in the news, like Bernie Evers at WorldCom or Bernie Madoff. And these are the people that are found to have true personality disorders. I love reading about these things after the fact, because usually the forensic psychologists get involved and spend a lot of time interviewing the perpetrators and asking them why they did what they did, and then writing these really great books and articles on them. And basically what it boils down to is at that level, there is usually some sort of a personality disorder, and most often it's a narcissistic personality disorder. And that's kind of what the general thought is as to what Bernie Madoff's issue was. They said, you know, possibly he was delusional, he really didn't think what he did was that wrong, he didn't show any empathy for his victims, including some victims that were very close to him, because he did take money from members of his extended family. It wasn't just friends and companies and nonprofits. So they're saying he possibly has narcissistic psychopathic tendencies. And in reading about this gentleman in Kansas City that I was just referring to, if any of you all have Netflix, there's a series on there right now called Dirty Scoundrels. It's a Netflix series. He's episode number 2. His name is Scott Tucker. And if you watch the episode and listen to what the man is saying about what he did, he shows no remorse, and it's all, oh, poor me. They're mean to me. Why are they doing this to me? And I'm not a forensic psychologist, although I hope to be when I retire. I think it would be really cool. But I'm seeing a lot of the same types of things I've seen written about some of these other high-profile fraudsters in that gentleman as well. And when it comes to these occupational frauds are usually not committed by the most disliked person in the organization, the person that everybody would think. They're actually usually committed by someone who's extremely trusted within the organization. And if you think about that for a minute, it makes sense. To perpetrate a long-time significant occupational fraud, you have to be able to have access to the assets or the funds. You have to be able to have access to the accounting records so that you can cover up what you've done. And to the extent anybody would ask you any questions about it, you have to have an authority in your position to answer their questions and pretty much have them stop looking right there. So the majority of the time, significant fraudsters are long-term employees that have been there for a very long time. At small to medium-sized businesses, very often the owners will make comments like, I considered them a member of my family. I had one client a few years back that I actually ended up investigating the CFO of the same company 3 different times. And that was because the first time he committed the fraud, the couple that owned the company were extremely wealthy. They said, you know, he must have been between a rock and a hard place, and had he come to us and asked us for the money, we would have given it to him. Everyone deserves a second chance. So, you know, they didn't fire him, they didn't even demote him, they kept him on, and 18 months later, they call again, Sean, we have a problem. I kind of laughingly say, has anybody talked to the CFO? And they said, oh, no, 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 he would never be involved. He and his family have become very, very close with us. In fact, he's the godfather of our youngest child now. Well, sure enough, when I got there and did the investigation, he'd done it again. So about another 12 to 18 months passed, and I get the third call. And this time, I go out to the company, they're in Kansas City, and I just kind of wave at the receptionist because I walk through the door. Because over the last 3 years, I've been there often enough, she knows exactly who I am. And I just walk down the hall to the CFO's office. His door's open. He's on the phone. I just kind of wave at him, and he waves me and says, you know, sit down. Wait for him to get off the phone. So when he gets off the phone, I just look at him, and I say, I'm back. And he said, I knew you would be. He had taken him for $1.5 million that time. Now, that's the one and only time I've actually fired myself from a client. I'd investigated the same guy at the same company 3 different times, and each time the client said, oh no, he will never do it again. He's a great guy. We're going to give him another chance. My position was, at some point, you're going to be filing bankruptcy, and I'm going to be sitting here talking to a judge explaining why I told you 3 times this guy had done something bad and we should fire him, and you didn't, and I'm somehow complicit in your company's bankruptcy. So I told him, you're really great people. Love to see you socially. Please don't ever call me again professionally. I lost track of the company a couple of years ago. I don't think it's still around, but as far as I know, he was there until the bitter end. And I often wonder exactly how much money he did take them for. But you know, I did get invited to some social events at their home after I was no longer working for them, and he was always there. So apparently he had been able to maintain that relationship. So frauds are most frequently committed by trusted employees, and usually it's going to be in the accounting or finance group if we're talking about an occupational fraud. And those check tampering, billing, and corruption fraud schemes are the 3 most common types of fraud schemes that are perpetrated by accounting or finance level employees. We've got a recent example, one, and this is one that I'm still investigating right now. We finished up the first level investigation, but it's going to be criminally prosecuted. And so we're going to help the prosecutor in that. In this particular situation, there was a individual who was an office manager of a company. She had been with them for over 40 years. She was 72 years old when this happened. And they had been asking her to retire and asking her to retire, and she had been kind of saying, no, no, no. So finally, about 6 months before everything comes to light, they hire someone else to become the office manager, and they tell their existing office manager, you're going to need to retire in the next 6 months. Will you please work with the new person and kind of get her trained and get them transitioned? And so that's what was happening. So on May 2nd of last year, they had a retirement party for the original office manager. And she goes home, she has a very nice party, goes home, the new office manager takes over all the responsibilities by herself that week. And by May 10th, she's in the owner's office telling them that she has identified $400,000 worth of checks that the previous office manager had written out of a corporate account to herself. So at that point, we get involved, do our investigation, and what we found was that over a 10-year period, this woman embezzled $3.6 million, primarily by writing checks to herself or her husband or their personal vendors. One of her other schemes, though, was actually that she had opened up a second, we called it the ghost account. It was a corporate account that she moved corporate monies into, but the company didn't know they had that account. The bank thought it was the company's account. The company had no knowledge of it. So she moved millions of dollars into that account and wrote checks directly out of that account to herself. Now, how does somebody steal $3.6 million over 10 years without anyone knowing about it? It means no one was looking. This office manager had complete control of the company's finance and accounting. She had access to the bank records. She did the bank reconciliations. She was responsible for payroll. She had was the one who had the corporate credit cards. She did all the AP transactions. She set up the vendors. The company effectively could not have run if she had taken a really long vacation, because they wouldn't have been able to take care of their back office business. But the people that owned the business, you know, they weren't accountants. Finance was not their background. They were out doing what they were trained to do. They had hired someone a long time ago to take care of their back office for them that they thought had their best interest at heart. So they never bothered to look. And when we do fraud investigations, one of the first things we look at are the copies of the canceled checks that come back. You know, in your bank statements, you now get the images of the checks back. You just look through those, and the first thing you look for is, who are the checks payable to? Do you see any employee names on there? And when you start seeing employee names and the amounts of the checks are $250,000, anyone, if they had seen that, which they would have had to bother to look, would have known that they had an issue well before it had gone on for 10 years. So that's the type of very common fraud situation that we see perpetrated by accounting employees. Operation employees, it's more on the corruption, billing, and non-cash side. And it just so happens that those are the three most common fraud types that we see in the construction industry. So we're going to get into those a little bit more. One other thing I wanted to bring to your attention, though, a lot of times there are some pretty significant red flags about the fraudsters. And sometimes these red flags are the brightest red in hindsight. They're more kind of pink sometimes when they're actually occurring. So I never fault anyone for not seeing all of them, you know, when it's actually going on. But these are the types of things we are on the lookout for. We are looking for people who are living beyond their means. So let's take, for instance, they have a salary of $40,000, but they live in a million-dollar house. So you're looking for some inconsistencies. They're spending more money than you think their family could probably bring in based on what you know of their employment. Situations where they have high personal debt. In the background checks, I always recommend to my clients to make sure that you pull a credit report. When you pull the credit report, what you're looking to see is, does this person have a lot of debt? Are they highly leveraged? Have they declared bankruptcy in the past? You're looking for evidence of financial stress. Because if they do have financial stress, you might want to think twice about hiring them into accounting or finance. They might be perfectly fine somewhere else in your organization where they don't have access to your funds or your accounting statements, but I'd be concerned about accounting or finance. A lot of times we see individuals will have a wheeler-dealer attitude. The rules don't apply to them. If there are good internal controls in place, these are the people that are breaking the rules or trying to circumvent those controls. The people that want to beat the system, that kind of goes back to the guy I told you about who stole the money and put it in the bank account, doesn't it? He had an axe to grind. He knew there was an issue there, and he was going to prove to everybody that, you know, he was the smartest guy in the room and that he could play the system and perpetrate the fraud that he thought could be perpetrated. And then, of course, we see the addictive behaviors such as gambling, drinking, and drug use. The last thing I wanted to leave you with on the occupational fraud before we get into the construction-specific stuff is that tips are the number one way that frauds are detected. And normally the tip comes from employees, but we've seen them come from vendors and customers of the organization as well. And so it's a really good idea that companies make sure that they have a simple, very straightforward way for their employees to let them know when they have an issue. So we spend a lot of time talking to our clients who have been victims of fraud about implementing confidential third-party hotlines where if an employee believes there's something amiss, they have a way to let someone know without there being any potential repercussions. And those have been found to be very, very effective. The kind of graphic I have at the bottom is out of that report to the nations from 2016. And it's showing that tips the number one method, management reviews number two, internal audits number three, but by accident is number four, and is always that high on the list. And what that basically means is we occasionally stumble over fraud. And what that tells me is a lot of companies really aren't doing enough in the way of being proactive to make sure they've got controls in place so that a fraud can't occur. All right, so let's talk about fraud in the construction industry specifically here. So the top three types of fraud that we see in the construction industry are corruption, billing schemes, and some non-cash schemes. Let's go through each one of these. So what is a corruption scheme when I talk about that? Corruption is any time you've got an employee who misuses his or her position of authority within the organization for their own personal benefit. And it used to be that the benefit was a monetary benefit to themselves. What we're seeing a lot lately is the benefit maybe for somebody close to them. So a brother-in-law's company or the wife's mother's company or something like that. They don't always get the direct benefit from it. And there's four primary types of corruption that we see in this particular area of fraud. There's bribery, economic extortion, illegal and improper proceedings, and then conflicts of interest. So let's go through each one of those. Bribery is actually a kickback is the most common form of bribery that we see in our investigations. And a kickback is a undisclosed payment. I've got payment in quotes there because it's not always cash. Offered and made by vendors, usually to employees of a company that are involved in the purchasing or contracting activities of the organization. So if you look at the construction company, we've seen this before in the past where let's say you've got an organization that has a very large construction project to be let. And everybody wants to get the work on that. You know, I've got a client right now that I'm doing a construction audit for, and the projects I'm looking at are each in the $60 million range. And so when you take a contractor's fee of 3.5% of that, you're talking about a couple million dollars. So this is big money here. And some people will kind of break the rules a little bit, and they'll kind of want to sweeten the deal and kind of build a relationship with the purchasing employees of the owner's representative to kind of help them get a leg up on whether or not they can get the business. So obviously we still do see cash payments being made, but a lot of times now it's no longer cash, it's some sort of an expensive and lavish gift. So we've got free travel, lavish entertainments. I've seen a lot of sporting tickets. You know, back a couple of years ago, 2014, when the Royals won the World Series in Kansas City, we saw World Series tickets in a couple of issues. Loans, and in many times these loans will either be interest-free loans, or there will be loans that once we dig into it were actually never repaid. So in reality, they weren't a loan, they were a gift. See that a lot. We see the company whose employee is making the bribe, allowing the person who's being bribed to use the corporate credit card to make personal expenses. I've seen a situation where we had a gentleman who bought a car that was worth about $5,000 on a blue book basis from someone who was involved in letting the contract, but the guy paid $20,000 for it, so that $15,000 overpayment there pretty much was a bribe. And then we've seen hidden interest in business transactions as well. So these are all very common types of bribes that we can send. So again, don't just think cash anymore when you think bribes, because in reality, that's probably not the major thing given anymore. Now in the construction industry, when it comes to bribe, the number one scheme that I see this used in is some sort of a bid rigging scheme. I'm sure everybody here is familiar with what a bid bidding scheme basically is. It's, normally when I see it, you will have a group of contractors, and sometimes they actually have relations, like financial relations between the contractors, and sometimes not. But they get together and basically decide that they're going to do some sort of a round robin where every so often one of them wins the bid and they each kind of get their turn. So they all get together and talk about what they're going to bid or how they're going to submit their bid so they can basically control who gets the project on that particular bid. And it usually involves also a payment to a purchasing company employee to assist them in getting the bid, because quite frankly, with a lot of owner representatives, you've got a small group of individuals who are involved in purchasing, and they see all of the RFPs, all of the bids, and you can see these things happen over time. They keep track of who's successful in these projects, and you'll see these repeat patterns. So often there is a bribe involved in these bid bidding schemes as well. And often the winning bid is also above market price, so there may be a built-in benefit to the company whose employee is perpetrating the bribe as well. So the next one is economic extortion, and this is basically the flip side of bribery. So bribery is where you've got an employee from the vendor who is bribing the company who's letting the contract, and they're doing this before the contract is awarded in order to get the contract. On economic extortion, you've usually got a purchasing employee of the company letting the contract who's going to the vendors and saying, I'll give you good, do you a favor here, but it's going to cost you. So they're basically asking to be paid. But after that, transactionally, it works exactly the same as a bribe works. And then we have illegal and improper gratuities. It's similar to a bribe, but it usually occurs after the purchasing decision has been made. So it's more of a thank you. Thank you for hiring our company. But this can be a really, really gray area, because a lot of gratuities, or things that can be considered to be improper gratuities, look and are marketing efforts. So for instance, I have an investigation going on right now in another state that involves a $60 million project that was let by an organization and is being paid for with public funds, paid for with state funds. And there are state statutes that say, if you are letting a contract paid for with public funds, you have to be very, very careful about what you accept from anyone who may be bidding on your contract. And it says you can have meals of no more than $20 per occurrence, and you can only accept meals totaling $50 from any one vendor in a year. Well, a lot of contractors, let's take construction industry out of it, in any industry, a lot of relationship building is taking people to lunch, taking them to dinner, sponsoring golf tournaments, that type of thing. In some cases, under certain state statutes, if you break these limits, you have caused a state violation, which in some cases can cause a contract to be voided. So these can be very, very serious. Now, in the case that we're looking at right now, we actually have a couple of instances where these statutes have been breached. They spent more money than $20 or $50. We also, though, in these bigger cases, don't see any evidence of any bribe going on. It looks to me like it was purely a marketing effort. People were doing business like they always do business. On the private side, that's done all the time, and there's no harm, no foul. But just kind of a heads up, if you're working on a project that's funded by public money, these types of efforts can unintentionally get somebody in hot water. And the last one we're going to talk about are conflicts of interest. And this is usually where you've got somebody at the organization that has an undisclosed interest in some organization that would be benefiting from the transaction. The one that we most often see will be that somebody has an ownership piece in a transaction, or a company that's going to be getting a contract or something like that. And it's a concern because it can result to rigged bids, inflated prices, the other things I have listed on the slide here. The thing about conflicts of interest, though, is that just because someone has a relationship with an organization doesn't mean it's a bad conflict. People have relationships. So for instance, in the same $60 million project that I'm talking about right here, within the group that manages the construction for the owner's representative, there is a woman who is married to one of the guys who works for the CMAR who's working on this big project. So one of the things we had to look at was there any communication between husband and wife that would have helped his company get the project? There wasn't, and in fact, the company had taken safeguards to make sure nothing had happened. First of all, I think they'd been recently married. I think they'd only been married about 14 months. And as soon as they got married, she did a formal disclosure in writing to her employer saying, hey, I married Joe Smith. He's over at the CMAR every year, just so everybody knows, and going forward. So what they did was they would make sure she was not the project manager on any project that his company was a CMAR on. So in that case, they still have a technical conflict of interest, but the way that they're managing it is causing no harm. So that happens, and as long as it's disclosed and everybody kind of knows what's going on, it's usually no harm, no foul. But then we have situations like this example here. This is on one of my other projects, still a significantly large project. It's getting ready to go out for bid, and they were kind of surprised when they only received two bids on their project, because at the pre-bid conference, there had been quite a few well-qualified vendors, construction companies, there to hear all about the project and get, you know, all of the pre-information and documentation that was going to be made available. And a lot of these companies, the potential subs, had worked for the general contractor before. They had existing experience, and so they had every expectation that they were going to have several bids. So when it comes down to the two bids, they're really, really surprised. So Sub A was a company that had worked with the general contracting company a lot, and they were very well thought of, and they actually had the lowest price bid by a little bit. But the GC also knew that Sub B was basically covered up with a lot of projects. They had a lot of things going on in several different states, and this particular project had a very tight timeline, and so there was concern that Sub B would not be able to perform in time and would cause some delays on the project. And so even though they were the low bid, since there wasn't a lot of difference between Sub B and Sub A, they went with Sub A. And in part, it was due to the fact that Sub B's schedule might be problematic. So the project gets started, and very, very quickly, there's this just slew of change orders coming in from Sub A. And when we got to looking at the change orders, we noticed that the change orders weren't running how we normally see change orders run. I mean, in my experience, the majority of the time, the change order comes in and it goes through the construction, the general contractor or CMAR, and then it goes to the owner's rep for approval before anything happens. In this particular case, we had the project manager approving the change orders prior to the owner seeing the change orders. That might happen occasionally, but it shouldn't happen all the time, and this was pretty common here. We also, in many cases, the change orders didn't go to the owner until the work was actually completed. So that's a problem. And the owner was very, kind of chagrined about this. And on about 3/4 of these change orders, they at least initially pushed back and said, we're not going to pay these until you give us additional justification and documentation. And at this point is kind of where, we get pulled in and they say, we want a construction audit done because things are not going here as we think they should, and we are just concerned and want to know. Basically, we want to feel better and know that everything's okay. But in reality, everything wasn't okay. So when we get into the construction audit, these are the funny things that we found routinely. We found that the project manager was allowing Sub A unapproved substitutions, which did not meet spec. The required bonds and insurance were not provided. Change order pricing was not what it was supposed to be. And there was unauthorized overtime and premium time, and there were a slew of other things as well. So, at the end of our investigation, what we discovered was that there was a conflict of interest because the CEO of Sub A was the project manager's brother-in-law. So they had a familial relationship there. And when we did a look back on other projects that sub had been involved in for the GC, what we found was that the project manager was awarding a lot of work to Sub A on projects that he himself managed. But Sub A wasn't chosen that often on projects managed by other project managers within the firm. And in each case, Sub A had not been the original low bidder, but there was some sort of a normalization adjustment or other special circumstance that allowed the project manager to say, because of this, we should select Sub A. So in reality, on the projects that Sub A worked for, a lot of times, because of the change orders, the value of the projects for their work, part of the project, was increasing significantly from what they had originally bid. The average increase on the ones we looked at for Sub A was about 50% over value, whereas when we looked at the other subs working on the same projects, they averaged 5 to 10% over. So the overage in and of itself wasn't that big of an issue. That happens a lot in construction. But 50% on several projects is very concerning. And this hadn't come to light in previous projects for the GC because those projects that Sub-A had worked on had all been profitable. But for a number of unrelated reasons, this particular project had lots of issues with it. And the GC was not going to be realizing, you know, the profit that they thought that they had or that they originally expected. And so this came to light. So the outcome was what we determined after doing some interviews of some of the companies that attended the pre-bid conference but chose not to bid, was that basically they were all very aware of the relationship between the guy that the CEO of Sub-A and the project manager for this GC. They had seen this happen a lot in the past. So they showed up at the pre-bid conference and kind of went, oh, that guy's the project manager. Okay, fine, and they're Sub-A. We know how this is gonna go, so we're just not gonna bother because we're gonna put in all this time and effort and we're not gonna get the bid anyway. So they realized there was a conflict of interest. And we also found, you know, that the PM knowingly allowed Sub-A to substitute poor quality materials and overcharge on change orders. So it wasn't that he wasn't aware of it, he was aware of it, he was participating. So he was colluding in a fraud. Now, he denied receiving any sort of compensation for this, but in reality, after his brother-in-law's company was awarded this project, the brother-in-law paid for the extended family to take a two-week European vacation. So I would call that a legal gratuity. In fact, I did call that a legal gratuity. But again, in this case, you know, it wasn't an outlay of cash. It was the cost of the European vacation for Guy and all of his family. That's a little bit of an extreme. I mean, there's a lot of things going on in that one. But quite frankly, a lot of times when things go wrong in construction projects, they go very, very wrong. So it's not that uncommon for us to see, you know, not all of those happening in the same project, but maybe a handful of those things on the same project. So these are some of the red flags that we look for corruption schemes when we're dealing with construction industries. We're looking again for that lifestyle element where you've got maybe a purchasing or contracting employee for the owner's rep that has a lifestyle that exceeds what their salary would expect, lead you to expect they could support. Also, we pay attention if we've got a purchasing or contracting employee who shows a keen interest in supporting one particular company getting an award or a particular PO being given to a particular sub or supplier. We look to make sure change orders have sufficient justification. If they don't, on a repeated basis, if there's a pattern there, and that's something we pay a lot of attention to. Unexplained or unreasonable limitations on the number of potential subs contacted to bid is another one as well. And then we pay attention to unusual bid patterns. So we are looking for bids that are too close. We are also looking for bids that may be too far apart. So let's say you've got a lot of bids that kind of cluster around, you know, a couple of $1 million level, and then you've got one bid that's $750,000, so you've got like a $250,000 difference there. That's pretty significant. Most contracts that I see, most of those subs, everybody kind of knows what things cost and how much effort is going to be into it. In reality, when you line out your bids, they're normally within a fairly, you know, reasonable range. So outliers, significant outliers really do stand out. And then bids that come in just round lot dollar amounts, no forensic accountant likes numbers that end in three zeros because most commercial transactions do not. There's a fee, there's a tax, there's something that makes them end in other than zero. So we pay attention to those. We're concerned if the same company is always winning a particular procurement, kind of like the Sub-A from my recent example, who's always been chosen on anything that particular project manager worked on. If they're playing round robin, where they've got a group of companies that are always bidding, and it seems like they all just are taking turns. Fewer than normal competitors to submit bids, so kind of back to my example I just had, where we just had the two people bid. And then different contractors that are making identical errors on their bids. I actually had a project a couple of years ago where the bids came in and they had these nice glossy presentations. And for five of the bidders, there were substantial sections that were verbatim the same. It is obvious they had shared a bunch of information. And there were other indications that there was bid rigging as to that as well. But the first thing we noticed is, gee, these are all reading really, really similarly. I wonder, did they find them on the web? What's going on here? We also look for situations where they're losing bids, do not comply with the bid specs, or only one bid is complete and the others aren't, so they get kicked out for some reason. Situations where the bid price is dropped when they're a new or infrequent bidder submits a bid is also one. And then this last one, I've seen it go wrong several times. I've also seen it become pretty standard, though, as well, where you've got a successful bidder who then subcontracts out some of their work to some of the guys that bid on it as well and didn't get it. In some cases, if there are other red flags, we pay a lot of attention to that. If that's the only thing going on, usually there's really nothing untoward going on behind that. So, anti-fraud controls for corruption. Corruption is the hardest type of fraud to investigate because it is largely what we call an off-book fraud, which means you don't see evidence of it run through your accounting records. And with financial fraud, that's normally what we're dealing with looking for the fraud. In this case, it's really more the behavioral things, right? How the companies that are bidding are acting, those types of things. So we pay attention to unusual employee behavior, unusual relationships, if somebody's got too close of a relationship with somebody, and then we monitor for the unusual bid patterns that I just went through. So how do you do this? Well, what we do and have some of our clients that have had issues in the past do is you put together basically a database of information that you can then do trending on to look for anomalies or patterns. So we've got for each bid and award received, actual cost per contract, cost per square foot, basically any type of information that is of interest to you. You just collect it over time, put it into a database, and then you're doing trending and comparing historical data. So this is what I refer to as data analytics. So here you may be looking at your metrics on a year-to-year basis. It can be project to project. You can be comparing companies that are bidding within the same job codes, that type of thing. There's a variety of ways that you are looking on it. But again, really what you're looking for are departures from normal trends and anomalies, and that's where you want to focus your time and effort. Okay, so let's go on to billing fraud. Billing fraud is actually the most common type of fraud that I see across any industry that I investigate, and it's basically anytime you've got a person, or an employee usually, that causes their employer to pay for something that the employer did not receive the benefit of. So a lot of times what we'll see is the employees will set up what we call fictitious vendors, and they will charge and make up mock invoices and charge their employer for goods or services that the employer never received. And many times, the way we find these types of billing schemes is by actually taking what's called a vendor master list, which is a list of all your vendors that has all their contact information, so their address, their phone number, sometimes it's got their tax ID. And taking the same list from your employees, and then you put them into the same Excel spreadsheet, and you sort on addresses or sort on phone numbers. You'd be surprised how many times the fraudsters don't even bother to make up a fictitious address or phone number. They would use their personal address and phone number. I have an example from a couple of years ago where we were working for a municipal water company up in Nevada, and they had an issue that resulted in a senior member of their organization just disappearing. He just left one Friday after a sensitive discussion, and the next Monday he had cleared out his office and didn't come back. They had reason to believe that there were some issues going on. We get hired, we go up there, and I asked them, I said, well, can you go into your J.D. Edwards accounting system and print out for me every contract that he has been able to approve under his sole authority that nobody else had to look at? And the CFO said, well, we can do that, but it's not going to lead to much because that wasn't the main part of his job responsibilities. He only did that on an emergency basis. And I said, well, if you could just kind of humor me, I'd kind of like to just be able to check the box and know that I took a look at this because based upon what you've told me, I just want to see what this says. They come back in a little while. They don't just have a few sheets of paper. They have a stack of paper. What we very, very quickly saw was that the gentleman had stole $2.2 million in a two-year period through two fictitious entities. And the way we could tell they were associated with him was that the address was his address and the phone number was his cell phone number. Took all of, however long it took them to run that report and give it to me. That's how long it took to discover that fraud. And we see that a lot. We see that a whole lot. And that happens when you have management in the organization that doesn't have good internal controls and no one's looking. They don't feel they have to cover it, they don't bother. Now, in the area of construction industry, billing schemes go a little well beyond that in many cases. We can have inflated or false pay applications. billings for work not performed, a variety of change order reviews, billing personnel rates that are higher than the agreed upon rate tables. There are a wide variety of things that can be done on the construction area when it comes to billing schemes. So when we do construction audits, we sit down and go through the pay applications with a fine-tooth comb. And it depends on if I'm working for the contracting company or I'm working for the owner's rep, exactly what procedures we go through. But the end result is, in either case, we're trying to make sure that whatever hits the pay app is legitimate, it's well-supported, and that it's being charged to the correct project or job. So when we look at inflated pay applications, these are kind of the red flags, things we look for. Most people use that AIA form. It's what I'm used to seeing, and if I don't see it, I immediately think, why am I not using the form? So that's one of the first things I look at. Erroneous totals or line items, roll forward errors. In my example of the organization I'm working with right now that has a $60 million contract, we've had to really get into the nitty-gritty on this one. We've been through, oh my gosh, 60 payoffs already. And everything works fine until payoff 30. And at payoff 30, the contractor fee gets squirrely. The math no longer works. It's a really straightforward contract. Contractor 3 fee is 3.5% of the guaranteed max price. So at any point in time, with some adjustments, I ought to be able to take 3.5% of what's been going through the payoffs, and that ought to be on that line. So at payout 30, it gets a couple of $1,000 off, and by payout 32, it's $110,000 off. So I'm in my office, and I can't figure it out. We set up a call with the CMAR's representatives, and they're walking me through it, and they're assuming I know nothing about construction, which I'll admit, don't put me out there to build something. You wouldn't want to walk through the door. But I do understand the accounting behind it. And so he's saying, well, there's this adjustment and that adjustment, and blah, blah, blah. And I said, well, okay, let's make this real simple. Tell me this. Should the contractor fee at this point be more than 3.5% of this number? And I'm taking the number off the payoff. And he says, no. And I said, it's $110,000 more. And he's like, oh. We'll get back to you on that. So, it was an honest mistake in that particular case. There was no fraud intended. There was a math error that had gotten carried forward into an Excel spreadsheet and just compounded on itself, and sometimes that happens. But, had we not been going through the minutia of checking everything on the pay app, the owner could have ended up paying at least $110,000 more than they should have. Although, I do believe probably at the end somebody would have found this before the building was finished. The other thing we see is change order abuse. These are the types of things we're looking for. We're making sure that there's appropriate justification and that unusual or unexplained change orders that are always approved by the same employee on a project, we look into that. The one that I've seen a lot of recently on some of my work is pattern of a low bid award being followed up by a lot of change orders. So back to my $60 million project, we have one particular sub on that one who's low bid for part of the project for $2.8 million. So 16 change orders later, we're at $6.9 million. How do you get from 2.8 to 6.9? Well, in that particular case, part of the issue was the architects were not done designing the building before the bids were let. And so there were a lot of legitimate change orders in there. But it has made it very difficult to say, go back to the owner and say, you've gotten what you should have paid for here, everything's as it should be, because in this particular case, there are some policies for the owner that require that any change order over $150,000 or 10% of the original bid be rebid, publicly rebid, because this is public money, and that was not done. So all we've got now is a building that's got a whole bunch of this particular structural component in it that you can't take out, but there's a very strong possibility that perhaps the owner has paid more than they should have because the change orders did not follow the process that they should have. Anti-fraud controls for billing fraud, scrutinize the line items, maintain an organized billing and filing system, that'll get you an awful long way right there. Maintain and monitor accurate schedules of values and percentage of completion schedules. That's kind of where we see things get off fairly frequently. And then it's really, really important that you have appropriate segregation of duties from billing from that of the individuals that processes the payments. And the last thing we're going to talk about here are non-cash schemes. We'll just hit this real quickly. A non-cash scheme is exactly what it sounds like. It's where the employee is stealing something other than money. And in construction companies, you guys have lots of really cool tools and, you know, big machines and building materials that people can, you know, walk out with. And sometimes they do. So that's what we usually see. You've got, you know, building materials that go missing, or an employee misuses or borrows without approval a tool over a weekend and it doesn't come back, that type of thing. Red flags, shrinkage or missing tools, materials, equipment, etc. And the other one is employees who frequently visit the job site, warehouse, or storeroom outside of work hours. And I don't mean that the day stops at 5 and somebody comes back at 6 to pick something up. I mean somebody's there with a pickup truck at 1 in the morning. That's what I'm talking about. Anti-fraud controls for non-cash schemes, segregation of duties between requisition, purchasing, and receiving, and between payables, purchasing, and receiving, and then maintain physical security of inventory and supplies. I can't tell you how many times when I'm working on a project that has a lot of issues, we'll go out there and it's like, things aren't locked up. You know, they'll have a chain link fence, but it'll be open enough that I can like open it up and walk through it and pull stuff out behind me if I want, these types of things. And a lot of this stuff, I will admit, is common sense, but it can make a big difference when it comes to the non-cash schemes. So on the anti-fraud controls there, connect your physical inventory accounts on a periodic basis, make sure your inventory is up to date, and then please investigate any discrepancies. We've certainly had issues where we've gone and done an investigation, and internally the company had identified inventory issues in the past but had never run them to ground because they didn't have time, which maybe they legitimately didn't. By the time we got there, it ended up being a significant inventory shrinkage, and there was evidence of it that they had been aware of in the past and they just hadn't done anything about it. So the effective preventative tips there, a lot of them are the same as well. The segregation of duties. As I said, in general, we recommend a fraud or ethics hotline. They're not expensive these days, and there's a lot of vendors out there providing them. Consider having all your contract employees on the job site sign in and out. Check all your estimates for accuracy and compare your job cost estimates to actual costs. Review discrepancies. These are the types of things that we do frequently and are some of our first line anti-fraud controls and procedures that we apply that end up being beneficial. With that, I think I'm a couple minutes over. So if anybody has any questions, I'll be up here afterwards. Other than that, thank you for not falling out of your seats.